The purpose of this video is to give you a brief description of natural latex and to present you with an outline of making molds of exceptional quality by using the latex products that are produced by Cementex Latex Corporation. Natural latex is actually taken from the bark of the Hevea brasiliensis tree. It is a fancy name for the rubber tree. It is made very, very easily and very, very nicely by the plantations. They have perfected techniques for this over a period of years. An incision is made in the rubber tree. The rubber comes out of the tree in sap form, similar to maple that comes out of a maple tree in sap form. When Columbus discovered the New World, he found that the natives were playing with little balls made out of rubber and were throwing them through hoops. We can actually say that Columbus discovered basketball. It became a very, very big industry in many years later. Latex was also used by the local natives to waterproof their feet when the tropical rainstorms were coming down in torrential form. And they were also used by the natives to make various kinds of clothing. Today, all of the latex is produced in the Far East. There are some producing regions in areas of South America, but these areas are not producing a high enough quality of latex due to the destruction of the rainforest. The British, when they were traveling through South America, took some seedlings with them to the Far East. This was the beginning of the Malayan or Indonesian type rubber industry as we know it today. In this video, a good friend of mine named Joe Behnke, who I consider to be one of the finest mold makers in the United States or perhaps the world, will give us a step-by-step description of how to make a perfect mold by using natural latex. It will be outlined for you in a very, very simple and easily followed form. The first step in making a good mold with natural latex is to select your model and prepare the model for the mold making process. For this, I would like to introduce you to my friend Joe Behnke, who will now begin the mold making process.
All right, to start out, we're going to start talking about our models and the different mediums that they're made from. And the things that we're going to do with these models before we put any latex on. It's very important that you know about the mediums and that your models are made from so you can patch them properly. We have plaster here today and generally can be patched with plaster or clay. We're going to patch them with clay, which is the easier way to go and be the most easy for a beginning mold maker. On a reproductive model, you're going to have seam lines that need to be erased. We had to bring the model back to original, like it was the original piece. We take one of these Italian spatulas, or you can take an X-Acto blade or an old dental tool, and you get in here and you scrape this plaster and you clean these lines up. You bring them below the surface just a little bit because we're going to patch them with clay, and we need a little bit of area to work below the surface with the clay so we can build it up and bring the model back original condition and shape, and we check around the rest of it. Any other perfections sticking up or out, we want to scrape off before we put our paint on here. The reason why we're going to paint is because when we patch with clay, the clay sticks much better to the paint. It'll hardly stick to a plaster model or a concrete model at all. So we need some type of a paint or a shellac or something on the model, thin coat. We don't want to take away too much of the detail with too much paint. But your paint does give it a pliable surface for clay and stuff. Down in here, you can see there's a dent in its neck here near its Adam's apple. And we're going to take one of these tools in, and we're going to push this clay down in there. Just gradually work with this clay. This clay here is what they call a sulfur-free, oil-free type clay, which latex can be painted right over this without any fear of the latex having a reaction to it. You smooth it out. And we pretty much do this all over the whole model. If we look upside down, we're going to find a few holes. We'll take and we'll fill them. And we bring the detail of the wings and stuff right back into them with the tools. And just patching the model. And making it look nice. So it's important to take the time to make a good model and get everything patched properly and look it all over. I want to go over about the painting and the shellacking. We want to put just enough paint on there or spray it on there just to get a light coat covering everything. And the same thing with the shellac. When we shellac the model, we only want to have enough on there to cover the model, just a light coat. We don't want to fill in the detail. This model has already been patched and it's been shellacked, and we're ready to mount it to the board. Now we're going to mount it with a little bit of latex on the bottom of the mold here. Okay, we're going to put it right in the middle here. We don't want to gush out the sides. So we're going to keep it right in the middle here. I'm staying in the middle so it won't gush out the sides. Now we're going to place this on the board here. And center it. Notice the board has about a 2 to 2.5 inch border all the way around. That's generally what size board we want, you know, for the model. All right, we're gonna be claying in this beveled area here. We're gonna more or less seal the model right to the board, which makes it a nice model when you're finished with all the rubber. You'll notice that at the bottom of the mold, when it's inverted, that you'll have a nice straight edge all along the bottom here. The bevel itself is for getting away from the straight edge on the bottom of a model, which makes it very susceptible with chips. We take some clay and we roll it up in the snake. A piece of glass or a piece of countertop will be fine to roll this out on something flat. Roll that to about the thickness of your bevel. All right, you place this right in the bevel. Take our tool and push it in there nice and tight. Let me cut that bevel on the clay there. One other thing, we want to go over and just look at the model one more time, all the way around. We got it on the turntable now, and make sure everything's all okay. All right, we're ready now to paint rubber on the model, but I do want to talk to you about a couple things before you do that. When you're going to start rubber on a model, you need to schedule yourself to have enough time to get at least 2 or 3 coats on that model. Don't be planning on doing anything else but that. So that's important when you start a model that you have the time to get those 2 or 3 coats on. Don't start it unless you do. The first coat has to be put on evenly. It doesn't have to be a pretty coat. The rubber shouldn't be overworked with the brush. And we'll show that later on here. The second coat, we need to get on just as soon as the first coat dries. Don't wait. 8 hours or anything like that. You stay there after that first coat dries, you get that second coat out immediately. And this is more or less like an insurance policy from laminating problems and stuff like that. Your first coat dries a lot faster and cures a lot faster because it's going on a dry model. When we paint rubber to rubber, well, we generally have 30-40 hours in between coats that we can count on, but not the first coat. All right, now we're going to start painting the rubber. This is the first coat. I have my brush and soapy water here. Just, you don't have to bring the brush out. Just shake the water off just so it's fairly dry. You don't have to clean the brush because it's in soapy water. Soapy water keeps the rubbers from setting up on the bristles. Just start at the top of the model. Work our way down. More dabbing than brushing in this coat. We're trying to get into every little detail there is. Like I said, it doesn't have to be a real pretty coat. It has to be a coat that covers everything. So if you get a few runs or anything on the first coat, you're probably going to have a good 15 or 20 more coats that are going to go over the top of that. So those runs and little imperfections you get here in the first couple of coats are nothing to worry about. They'll be rounded out and look beautiful by the time you're finished with the mold, when you're finished painting rubber on the mold. The wings of this angel have a lot of detail. That's why I'm doing a lot of dabbing. We got to make sure that that latex gets in every little crook and cranny that's there, up underneath them. Remember, like I said, try to come on up and come right back up with the brush. Keep this brush on this angle as much as you can, and your brush will be much easier to clean. Make sure you get the rubber all the way up into the bevel. You're going to see a few little bubbles here and there, and that's generally because the model is dry. Anything you paint, whenever you paint on a dry surface, you're going to see some bubbles. So dab them out the best you can. What you can't get out on this coat, you'll take care of on the second coat. Make sure you paint your border a couple inches all the way around on the outside here. Don't let it taper out too much on the edge here. See, here's the inside, here's the outside. Keep that rubber the same thickness as best you can. A lot of people like to paint there and they wind up with nothing out here and real thick back here. Keep it all the same. We'll show you later why. We're going to show you how to clean this brush. This is nothing but clear water right here in this 5 gallon bucket. We're going to take and squeeze whatever rubber is in there out of there right away. Water out of there. It's kind of hard for you to see through there. See here. Next step, this is a dog brush, like a flea brush. And we'll go in there into the butt of the brush, and not the whole comb at one time, but just a little bit at a time. And we'll clean all the little bit of rubber that's out of there. It's starting to set up. Clean that out of there. Okay, and that gets all the rough, heavy chunks of rubber out of there. Take a good wire brush, a good stiff one, like this one here. So we take our brush and we drag it across there. That'll pretty much take care of all the little small, fine, hard chunks of rubber that are in the brush. But a good brush like this paints rubber much better. It lasts a lot longer, and it'll make a lot nicer mold for you. Now we're going to stick that back in our water and our soap. Let me just leave that soak in there. All right, we're going to make two seams on this model, one underneath the chin, so the rubber divides and pulls over the face easily without any stress. And we're going to put another one on this wing here. so the rubber will come off easily. First, we're gonna do the line underneath the chin. This line here is to guide you when you're making your seam, which we'll explain here shortly. We're gonna divide this wing right in the middle. And this is where our seam will go, right along this line. So when we trim and cut this aluminum foil, we have a guideline to go by, and it'll stay right with that line. It keeps us in reality where the division is for sure. So when we trim our tin here, we're going right back in the same spot. Because every time we take this off and trim it, we want to be able to put that back in the same place. This is a piece of tin here that we cut to fit that model of the angel. And we're going to put a lock in here. Now this is aluminum foil. This is like an oven liner, and we just flatten it out. We cut pieces out of the oven liner, and we flatten it out with a piece of wood. We're gonna make a lock here. We're gonna make the lock go from about right here to right here. We're going to keep it, this is the model right here, this area here. And we're going to keep that lock about a half inch, 3/4 inch away from the model, right in this area here. We're going to take a piece of tin and cut it the same length as that mark we made on the paper here, or close to it. Notice that's the same length. And now we're going to shape this into a U. And you take these two rail rulers, push down on that tin a little bit, and if you can see that, it's a U-shaped piece of tin there. It'll be shaped just over a round dowel or ink pen. We're going to trim that down on the sides. Against this mark here, and we're going to make some marks on it to know where we need to cut the hole. We're going to take an X-Acto blade. This is the way you should cut the hole in this aluminum foil. If you try to use a pair of scissors, you're going to tear it all up. This will cut you a very nice, neat line and hole in your aluminum foil, which is what you want. You want it to be nice and precision. I'm using the steel edge ruler to pull this knife along because it won't cut in to that steel edge. And now we're going to pop that little square out. That's your hole that we cut. See, there's no jagged edges. And this is the lock that we made. That's going to pop right in that hole there. And that's the hole we cut with our X-Acto blade. You can see it's not jagged. It's nice and machine fit, nice clean hole. Everything's nice and flat. Now the lock that we made, we're gonna pop into that hole. And we're gonna tape it in here. We just rip a piece of tape off as long as that lock. This side here, not the round side, but the side where the little tabs are sticking out, we're going to tape it right in there. One on each side. want to keep these in here nice and tight, because when we paint rubber around here, we don't want any leakage. This is going to form a lock, and I'm going to show you an example of it here shortly, what the finished product looks like. Now we're going to trim this tape. Just want to leave enough on there to hold that little lock in. Now we have to go on the other side here, and we have to close off the ends of this lock. So we take little pieces of tape and we put, close the end in. See that? Do the same thing in the other end. Now we're going to take and trim those. Closed in, all trimmed, and it's not going to leak. Okay, there's the lock. Tape on this side, holding it in. Here it is with the little pieces of tape. Closing the ends in. What this gives us, when we paint rubber on it, one side is the male, and the other side will form the female. When we pull the rubber off of this tin, this is the what look you're going to get when your mold is finished. You can see that. Okay, now when this mold goes together, all these locks fit inside each other, and they keep your seam aligned and straight. All right, now what we're gonna do is we're gonna attach this to the model with latex rubber. Now we're not gonna paint the whole thing. We're gonna paint a little bit down here. And we're gonna get a little middle here, just enough to attach it. We can take pieces of clay or other objects and just lean them up against the foil, and that'll hold it there until this latex dries. And there'll probably be three pieces on this model before we're finished with the seam. So by painting a little bit in the middle, that leaves a flexible each piece going up the model. And when this rubber dries, it makes it more pliable. You can do more to it. You can bend them around and tape these ends together, and it'll all look like one piece of tin. Now here's the model I promised to show you. Here's the three pieces of aluminum. They're all taped together. They're taped together here, they're taped together here. If you notice, you can hardly see a line at all between any of them. Then when they're all dry, then we tape them all together. Then we finish up painting the whole seam all together. Then it makes one nice solid seam and nice tight seam. Remember what I said about cutting the aluminum foil. Cut it as close to the model as you can. The more you do it, the better you'll get at it. On our first thickening here, we're going to make it almost into a paste. With that paste, we're going to fill in some undercuts like beneath the wings here, and we're going to thicken up around the base here and make this a lot stronger and stout. This is because when the mold is finished, this is an area that gets a lot of beading, and also make it retain its shape for much longer. That's the first thing we're going to do, and this is going to be a very thick latex, almost like a putty. We're going to take a little bit of latex here. Well, this procedure here is generally the procedure you do at the end of the day when you're going to let the model sit all evening. So this rubber can dry all night long and set up well, and even out your curing much better. We put quite a bit in here, and we're probably going to put some more in.
This will be like a paste that won't sag after you're done mixing it. So when you get that consistency, you've got enough powder in it. I also want to explain, when we use this real thick method here, you generally are going to paint rubber on a model for 2 or 3 days, and being you have that amount of time, you should do this procedure in the evening, every evening, and build it up gradually instead of trying to fill in a spot completely all in one shot. It's never a good idea to put anything on way too thick. All right, now you can see, we can bring that up the side and it doesn't sag, so that's thick enough. One of the places we like to put the pasted thick rubber is right at the base here. This makes a nice, tough, striking edge on the bottom of the mold. Now, putting it on in the manner I am right now, it's not real thick. This will set up overnight and be fairly hard in the morning, and you can continue your rubber painting on your model all day long. Now, we have other areas, like in around this leaf here, underneath these wings. These are spots that need to be filled in, so when you paint your latex on your coat after coat, everything starts rounding out, and your mother mold will release from these areas much easier. If you leave them cup underneath the wings and you start getting a hook-like looking rubber pattern, you're going to have problems getting your mother mold off of that. So we take and we fill in those areas. Generally underneath these wing tips is usually a problem. Every time you paint another coat of rubber, it kind of builds up on the edge of that wing, and after a while it'll make a hook. So that's what we're doing. We're kind of helping that out. We're always working and designing on everything. We start working with the model, then we start rubber, and we work with how we paint our rubber to make it an easy mold to work with. But also, when we put the mother mold on there, it's going to hold against the rubber tightly everywhere. There won't be any gaps. The more you do this, the easier it'll be for you and the faster it'll go. And there you have it. Section here, we're going to talk about mixing some more powder into the latex rubber and how much we can put in there for this model right here. We can put 15% powder in this rubber. In other words, 15% of what rubber is here, you know, we can put in powder. So we're going to put that right in the top of the rubber here. We want to mix this thoroughly, and it should be all smooth and not chunky when we're finished. Just keep mixing until it's extremely smooth. We start at the top as always and work our way down. If your rubber runs on you, don't worry about it. Get the whole model covered. And keep painting. Do crisscross patterns. Notice, as we said before, when we're painting, try and keep the brush up. The handle of the brush up. Get everything covered. Be careful on your seam. Maybe hold the back of it a little bit. Notice I'm not wasting any time getting this rubber on here. Get it all covered. Okay, it's pretty well covered now. Now we go back over it. If you have runs, just crisscross your brush over those runs. And it's not going to run on you when you start feeling that brush dragging a little bit on the rubber. When you're painting latex rubber, you can do as I'm doing here. You're kind of shaping that rubber around the objects of the model. my part of the heat curing is the amount of time and the temperature. Try to keep a controlled temperature. Put it in a little room, or build a little room to cure your molds in. When you cure the mold, let's try to keep this constant temperature, like 95 to 100 degrees, and keep it constant for that 8 to 10 hours that you're going to cure it. A model like this, 8 to 10 hours is fine, if you can keep that temperature constant. Also, keeping the moisture constant, too, the low amount of it. And take the time to make a little room out of some lumber or something, you know, and put a heater in there that will get the room to 95 to 100 degrees. And that's your insurance policy for curing this mold and having a mold that has a long life to it. It's not a process that you can cheat on. It's something that you do have to do. All right, now we're going to get into studying the model. And we're going to draw some lines on the model for making the mother mold. These are the pieces that go on the outside of the rubber to keep the rubber rigid when you pour it. For example, this is the mother mold here on this little gargoyle. And there's two other pieces that fit on here. And when we pour this, this is the mother mold, and that's what keeps the rubber rigid and keeps the rubber from collapsing or bulging. We're going to study this model right here, and we're going to make the lines on here where we want those divisions and how many pieces that we want on here. We have to study the model to figure out how many pieces we're going to have to put on the sides for that will come off of here. And we try to keep it down to a minimum of pieces on there because it makes this mold much simpler to disassemble. We can get by with one piece on the back here. So we're going to make a line for that piece. Front of this mold, we can get by with one piece here and one piece here, and those two pieces will come off. So we're going to make a split right down the front here. Notice I'm going off to the side of the leg a little bit here because we have this area right in here. If we split it in the middle, it'd have a little tough time coming off of this knee here. So we brought it off to the side just a little bit, which we won't have any problem with it coming off of here, and we won't have any problem with the mother mold coming off of there. So by shifting it over the kneecap just a little bit right down the middle of the knee, this mother mold, both pieces are going to come off easily. Now if we just went right straight down the middle here, it would probably hang on that knee. Now we decided where we're going to put our lines, and they're on there. Next thing we're going to do is get ready to put the clay dams on here for making the mother mold pieces. We're going to use clay bridges, and in order for the clay to stick to the rubber, we need to clean the rubber with some alcohol. Denatured alcohol is fine. We're going to take some on a little rag here. We're going to wipe down the area where we're going to apply that clay. Remember I said we're going to make this section, so we're going to wipe this area off, and we're going to wipe this area off, adjacent to the line. It's essential that the rubber be good and clean, or the clay will have a problem sticking to it. This is cured rubber, and the denatured alcohol won't hurt it a bit. It's what you use for partly what you use for the release agent. Now the clay I have here, I have warmed up to about 90 degrees. You can do that by putting it in a cardboard box and put a 100-watt light bulb in it. That'll warm it up to around 90, close to it. We just squeeze this out into a snake. It's probably about an inch to an inch and a half round. Okay, then we just flatten it with our hands. And then we're gonna push that right onto your mouth. Okay, the area right where the line is, you want to make absolutely sure that it's right up against the rubber. We don't want any gaps, especially by the line. Okay, then over here, away from the line, we're gonna just move that right into the rubber so it attaches very good. Okay, now we're gonna come down this side here. Remember, the clay has to be warm. Being the clay is warm, it will stick better to the clay, to the rubber. And it's easier to work with also. Remember, keep the clay flat and tight wherever the line is. It's important. All right, now we have our clay all attached by the line, and it's flat. Now we're going to trim that, and we're going to cut right on that line. And that's where we want to be, is right on that line, because it's necessary, because we're designing these mother mold pieces so they'll release from the model. If you don't go by your lines, you're going to have a problem. Okay, we're finished cutting the clay right on the blue line. You can see it here. I turn it over here, you can see it, the blue line here. We're right on the blue line. You notice we got a nice straight cut on the clay here. Now this is just the beginning. We're gonna put a flag onto this clay here. All right, now we're set up with this piece of glass and this rolling pin. That's going to be part of how we're going to make this flag or dam that we're going to attach to this other clay to finish our mother mold section. Now we're going to start out with a piece of clay about an inch and three quarter to 2 inches, right around there. We're going to roll that out a little bit. And we're going to take a rolling pin and we're going to flatten it. Clay doesn't have to be so warm for this part. Okay, then we're gonna just take and trim the edges a little bit so they're flat. Okay, and now we have a nice flat section there. And we're gonna attach that to the model here. Now clay is very pliable, you can do anything with it. So you can move it around, get it attached to here, get up to the top here, just cut it off. Okay, then we're going to take and smooth it into this first section that we already trimmed and cut. Look on the back side of this, flare it out toward on the back there a little bit so it does stay attached to that first layer of clay you put on. The beauty of this clay seam, it's very precision and it goes right to the base of the model, right to it. And you won't notice any gaps or anything in the mother mold. It'll be a tight fit, tight precision fit on the inside of the mother mold. If you can see in here, now these are the two pieces. And there is no gaps in this line here. It's precision all the way. I can't hardly feel the line. And that's what you want. You want that seam to be precision and tight on your rubber. Very important. Because if not, your rubber will take the shape of, if you have a gap in there like that, your rubber will take the shape of that gap after a period of time. And you'll start seeing that line in your produced piece. So we'll continue on here and we'll make the rest of the
section here. All right, now we have our clay dam, or clay bridge, whatever you like to call it. It's very nice looking, it's very precision. The only other thing we have to do to this now is put locks in it. See that little hump there? That's a lock. That keeps this thing from shifting when you make the mother mold. And we form these locks in the clay before you make your mother mold. So we're going to put one about right here. We just take our thumb. You make a little, maybe a little V shape there, like that, push it in, and just smooth it out a little bit. I'll probably put another one down here. I'll put one up here, and I'll put one down here. Just take our thumb and smooth it out, make it a nice lock. I don't know how good the camera can see these locks here, but that's what it will look like when you're all finished making your mother mold pieces. That's how they'll form. It'll be like a male and female after everything all sets up. That's what makes that lock. All right, now we're going to show you the finished mother mold fitted right onto one of these angels that we've been working on all through the whole video. If you look close here, you can see the some of the locks that are in this one. There's one here, there's one here. There's several on the back. There's one here. See the matching ones to this here. So they go together. So it doesn't shift. All right, we're gonna put some soapy water into the mold here, and when we pour the plaster in here, it'll make the plaster flow into the detail. If you don't do this and plaster pours, you'll wind up getting a lot of extra air holes, bug holes, and things like that. You're lubricating the mold for the plaster to flow through it, and you'll get a much better piece when you're finished. This is the plaster. We're going to sift it into this bucket here. Our main purpose here is we want to pour this model so you can see a finished product from the mold. I'm going to continue pouring plaster in here until it looks dry on top, until I'm satisfied with the amount of plaster that's in the water here. And then we'll stir it, sprinkling in the water easily, softly. Keeps the amount of air down in order to get a quality pour. We're getting to a point where that's enough plaster in the water. I'm letting this plaster sit for just a little bit there. If you let it soak a little bit longer, the plaster will mix easier, it'll have less clumps, and that'll make a much nicer pour. And when I stir with my hand, I get rid of all those clumps. It's nothing but smooth plaster going into this mold. And we're gonna roll this mold a couple of times, maybe three times, before we actually fill it all the way to the top. We're gonna fill it partway, and we're gonna roll that plaster all around into the detail. We're gonna take and pour this about half full. And you pour slowly, pouring slow, and along the side, makes the plaster flow along the surfaces of the rubber, and keeps the action of air building up down to a minimum. And now we're going to roll this mold. You can see some of those bubbles and suds there. That's some of the soap that we got. That's all right. Don't let it bother you. What that's doing, it's got the rubber lubricated, and the plaster rolls into your detail much easier. When you pour the plaster into the mold, it just simply pushes all your soap and suds out the top. But it's like a lubricant for your plaster to flow into the detail of the mold. Now if you can see that line of that wing there, and rolling it up and down that wing line, make sure it gets into all the detail and undercuts of that wing.
And the same thing with the face here. This is the face right here. And I'm rolling that plaster right into the face. And back and forth. Okay, now we've got a pretty good thick coat all the way around the whole model now. So I won't have to take and refill it too many times. I got the plaster just right. Now we're just going to take and pour this slowly back into the model. We're going to shake that, make sure it forms into the wings. This is what most people that pour plaster are looking for, a mix with hardly any air in it. Generally gives you almost a perfect piece every time. The reason why we dig this hole out is because the model sits much flatter because you don't have a hump in the middle. Plaster's got a habit of rising in the middle of your poured piece, and it wants to rock. If we cut that middle out, we won't have that problem. And that's it. That's about all we can do to it. Now we just have to wait, probably about a half an hour, and it can be removed from the mold. We can demold it. We're going to demold our plaster piece before, so we're going to put a little bit of talc on the wings here. So when we pull this rubber up, it'll pull across itself nice and easy. And we'll just start pulling that up. Don't pull all in one place, pull all the way around the model. A little bit at a time. And it'll come right up for you. Instead of pulling way up here, if the rubber is catching somewhere on your model, take and pull at it a little bit right there against the model and help it along. Latex rubber shrinks somewhat, but the more seco powder that you can put into your rubber, the less shrinkage you're going to have.
I would like to take this opportunity to thank Joe Behnke, our master mold maker, for the magnificent demonstration about making molds with natural latex. There are certain peculiarities that latex has associated with it, and would like to take the opportunity at this point to advise you of them and to discuss them with you so that when you are faced with these particular peculiarities or problems, you will know how to handle them. The first one is a term which sounds very, very fancy. It's called vulcanization. Now, vulcanization is not really as fancy as you think it is. It really means heating the latex and setting it at a certain temperature so that all the odd chains and the even chains of the rubber molecule come together and form one uniform surface. Vulcanization was named after Vulcan, who is the god of fire. So that when you actually heat up the latex to a certain temperature, usually between 100 and 120 degrees Fahrenheit for a certain period of time, usually between 8 and 12 hours or sometimes for a full 24 hours, the rubber mold will reach its maximum quality and you will be able to pour your concrete and plaster into this mold without having too many problems. Time also promotes vulcanization. So you can actually leave a mold at room temperature for 4, 5, or 6 days and it will vulcanize by itself. However, I should tell you that vulcanization by heat is probably the best way to complete your mold. There are certain other problems that are associated with latex, and I'd like to explain them to you. One is called delamination. Very often people put one or two coats of latex on the model and then perhaps go for a short vacation for 4 or 5 days. Then they come back and they find that they, when they're painting another layer of the rubber on top of the one that they left for 4 or 5 days, they find out that it peels off. Well, this is because vulcanization has already taken place, and when you put the other layer of rubber on top of one that has already been cured, there are no open pores in the underneath layer for the layer that you are coating to attach themselves to. As a result of this, it's just like one slick surface underneath the coat. As a result of that, you will probably get delamination. So be careful to coat your molds and coat your layers of latex within, let's say, a 36-hour period. Another thing which may occur is a process known as blistering. As Joe mentioned in the video, when you're painting rubber on a dry model, it is possible that you will get some very, very small bubbles appearing in the surface of the rubber. You can eliminate those bubbles by using an air hose and going over the layer of latex very, very gently. It will break up the bubbles that are underneath the latex. However, there is another phenomenon which I refer to as blistering. This usually occurs because when you shellac your model, you did not permit the shellac to fully dry. If the shellac is not fully dry, there are still some solvents that are evaporating from the shellac and are forcing themselves into the rubber, causing the rubber to either pull away from the model or to blister. You can eliminate the blister by using a syringe. On the other hand, it would be a very, very good idea if you left your model with shellac on it at least overnight or until there's no more noticeable odor of the shellac. It is also a very, very good idea to avoid ultraviolet light when working with latex. That means sunlight. That is because ultraviolet light has a tendency to affect rubber molds. It's best to leave them indoors and try to work as close to room temperature as you possibly can. Another thing that sometimes people talk to us about is puddling of latex. The latex will puddle if you do not try to brush it out of these areas with a few short strokes. That's no real problem anyway, since in the final cure, all of the rubber, including the puddles, will be cured or vulcanized. When you're working with concrete, it is a very, very good idea to use a solution of castor oil and alcohol as a separating agent. We recommend one part of castor oil, to 9 parts of alcohol. And it's very, very good to put a light coating of this in the interior of the mold, as it will make the cement slip out of your mold very, very easily. Castor oil also has a therapeutic effect upon molds and has a tendency to preserve them. Cementex has a special grade of castor oil which we sell specifically for this purpose. Another problem that you may have is separating your backup mold, which is usually made out of polyester resin or fiberglass, from your vulcanized rubber mold. Now this gargoyle, which we had shown to you previously, has been coated with a specially prepared high temperature wax, which resists both the heat and the chemicals that are in the fiberglass. When you have an opportunity, please give us a call and we will be more than happy to explain to you about this in greater length. We very often get questions from people about how thick they should make the mold. Generally speaking, we wouldn't want to make a latex mold that is thinner than 1/8 of an inch. When you demold your rubber, it sometimes has a tendency to stick to itself. It is very, very easy to cure this problem. Keep a small jar of talcum powder handy, and as you're pulling the rubber off the model, just dust it lightly with the talcum powder. This will prevent the rubber from sticking to itself. At this particular point, I would also like to say that to accompany this video, we have a catalog that you can use in conjunction with the video in a step-by-step process in preparing your natural rubber molds with number 80 and Seco powder. Cementex Latex Corporation is located at 121 Varick Street, New York, New York, 10013. We have an 800 number that is 1-800-782-9056, or you can reach us at our local number, area code 212-741-1770, or fax us at area code 212-627-2770. Our experienced staff is available to help you anytime you may need. Thank you very much. In addition to this, we sponsor a school known as the Joe Behnke School of Mold Making. As you have seen from this video, Joe is a very, very experienced mold maker. We hold classes from time to time and practically give you real one-on-one instruction in making molds. Just call our 800 number, that is 1-800-782-9056, and we will arrange for you, together with other students, to avail yourselves of the experience and excellence that Joe Behnke has gained through his years of experience in making molds. Thanking you once again.